Trapeze presents Frozen in Time, Fossils of the United Kingdom and Where to Find Them, written by Rhys Charles, read by Charles Armstrong. Introduction. Fossils provide a unique and fascinating look into the past, to glimpse a world that, whilst still our same planet, can seem truly alien. They tell a story of life across billions of years of Earth history, and though we're used to seeing this in museums and documentaries, it's still surprising just how many chapters of that story can be discovered on the shores right on our doorsteps here in the United Kingdom. From dinosaur footprints on the rocky beaches of Scotland, signs of some of the earliest complex life in the Welsh Black Shales, to the giant ocean-dwelling reptiles in the rich marine realm of England's Jurassic Coast. Major revelations in science are often thought of as experiments happening behind closed doors in laboratories. But what makes fossils so different is their accessibility. There are few other areas of science in which such breakthroughs can be made by a casual observer during a stroll on the beach. But this is precisely what fossil hunting can offer to the fields of paleontology, geology, biology, and even climate science. You don't need to have a PhD and access to masses of specialist equipment to potentially find great fossils. For such a small landmass, the UK is home to a surprising abundance and diversity of fossils, our country being as rich in ancient species as it is in accents. This includes those which are likely familiar, such as the intricate spiral shells of ammonites, but also those unlike anything alive today, like the saw blade resembling graptolites. And of course, there are that most famous group of extinct organisms, the dinosaurs, who also can be found here in Britain. Taking us on a journey through the country, from the apex of Scotland to the south coast of England, we'll explore some of the more intriguing characters to have inhabited the area before us and go on a whirlwind tour of the major groupings of prehistoric life and how they all link together as part of a bigger global picture. Our journey through the rocks will take us through over half a billion years of evolution, across the eon of time called the Phanerozoic, a 540 million-year expanse of time which includes three constituent eras. The first, the Paleozoic, stretches from 540 to 250 million years ago and sees the rise of complex animal and plant life, including the origins of most of the major animal groups we know today, such as insects, fish, and reptiles. The second is the Mesozoic, from 250 to 66 million years ago, best known as the Age of the Dinosaurs. Finally, there's the Cenozoic, from 66 million years ago to today, the time when mammals grew to dominate the Earth. Whilst places like the Jurassic Coast are famous for their geological history, it's easy to assume that there are no fossil hunting sites near you. By breaking down the country into 14 distinct regions, all of them featuring multiple sites, this book aims to show you that there are fossils to be discovered everywhere. Whilst not every fossil hunt will end with finding something spectacular, rest assured that armed with some basic knowledge on what to look for and how to go about finding fossils, even the most amateur fossil hunter will be equipped with the knowledge to unearth fascinating discoveries. One of the best tricks with fossil hunting is to keep an eye out for the irregular. Fossils are commonly different colours and textures from their surrounding rocks. So, on a beach dominated by grey stone, the flecks of black or white protruding outwards may be the sign of something important hidden inside. When the rocks are gritty like sand, the presence of smooth or reflective surfaces can be another sign that you've found something, a difference you can touch and feel as well as see. Alternatively, it can be good to look for the all too regular. Chunks of broken rock and cliff debris are usually without any particular form or shape, so it's unusual to see something that seems too perfect to have formed randomly. Spiral-shelled ammonites are a perfect example of this, as they are so different in geometry from anything around them. Pattern spotting is a handy skill, as a single depression in the rock can be overlooked, but when a series emerge in a row, you may have discovered a trail of footprints. We'll also explore some of the locations where the incredible geology of the country can be experienced, as well as places that may be quiet now, but have in the past been the epicenter for some of the biggest revolutions in science. There is so much to uncover that even as we embark on an exploration of all that is out there, waiting to be discovered, it is inevitable that some fossil types and names will be missed. Something that will no doubt earn me some jabs from my paleontologist colleagues, all of whom are certain beyond any doubt that the organisms they study are the most interesting and important to have ever lived. There are also certain fossil types that crop up time and time again. Brachiopods and bivalves, two names for groups of seashells. These regularly appear in the rock, looking much like their modern seashell counterparts, albeit made of stone. Often found as small, rounded shapes of smooth, reflective rock, they can also be preserved as circular outlines, or even half-moon crescents if found in cross-section. These organisms, grouped together under the umbrella term of small, shelly fossils, are by far the most commonly found fossils you're likely to encounter, their sheer numbers across time being so high, and those shells making them resilient and therefore more likely to survive as fossils and easier to spot. Similarly, there are many incomplete fragments of mysterious bones to be found, often stemming from long-extinct vertebrate animals. Such bones can be identified because they appear to be a regular shape in the otherwise irregular shape of a rock, like the thin curve of a rib or the long straight lines of limb bones. Though it can differ from location to location, bones like this can sometimes weather out to a honeycomb or fibrous texture, another trait to look for in the rock. The conical, peaked, triangular, or ridge shape of teeth are also common discoveries to be made. That said, geology can still throw curveballs with their deceptive mineral shapes, no more so than with something like a beef rock, which occurs when the mineral calcite grows in fibrous lines which can resemble the look of a fossilized bone or shell. One of the most exciting prospects when hunting for fossils is the knowledge that remarkable finds really can happen to anyone. Paleontology is a science littered with tales of unbelievable discoveries made by people with little to no prior experience or knowledge of fossils. From a 7-year-old child hurling rocks into the sea, only to stop because a particular stone looked funny, and then to report it and have it be a wing bone from a flying reptile, to people playing fetch with their dogs, who suddenly realize that they've been throwing around a small dinosaur femur. What is out there can amaze you, and anyone who is inspired to go looking has the potential to rewrite scientific history. But before we hit the field, let's go over some of the basics. Fossilization. The word fossil originates from the Latin fossilium, which means dug up or excavated. With this in mind, you could apply it to anything to have ever been dug up, but that is hardly scientific. There is no strict definition for what is and isn't a true fossil, but generally speaking, it is just a word used to refer to remains from the distant past. It's best not to get too worried with drawing lines in the sand. A fossil is formed when an organism dies and is buried by sediments, like sands, muds, and silts, while the soft body parts are normally either eaten or decay away. Over a very long time, this build-up of sediment is compressed into rock. Millions of years later, the rock and fossils are exposed to be found at the surface. However, there is more to the story than this alone, as a fossil is not the same coming out of the ground as it was going in. It has changed substantially. If you've ever held a fossil or seen one, you will know that the original material that formed it, the organic matter of the organism, is long gone, decayed away, and the object is now made entirely of rock. Commonly, this occurs as a result of mineralization. After burial in the sediment, water percolates through the remains, as the minerals dissolved within that water slowly precipitate out. This happens on a microscopic scale, preserving the finest details of the original organism. Essentially, if the feature was present when buried, it has the potential to be preserved. Frequently, this occurs with materials like silica and calcium carbonate, which make up the chemical composition of most fossils. But it can happen with other minerals too, as we'll see later. Another method of fossilization is direct mineral replacement, which commonly occurs in shelled organisms, such as the bivalves and gastropods of ancient seas. During this process, the original materials the shell was composed of, like the mineral aragonite, are replaced by more stable materials, like calcite. There's also carbonization, which is common in plant fossils, as we will see later. Fossilization takes a very long time, but not all fossils have been fully fossilized. For example, Ice Age animals lived only a few thousand years ago, not the millions we tend to link to paleontology, but we still call them fossils. Some research papers have even referred to bones only a few centuries old in this manner. Fossilization is a difficult process that is easily disrupted, whether by natural forces or other living creatures, and only a very small percentage of living things will successfully be preserved. It requires so many elements to be in order. A creature needs to have died in the right place, have their bodies not be overly disturbed, to be correctly buried, and held safely underground. It's difficult to fulfill all these conditions for even a single bone, let alone full skeletons, and the process is biased towards sturdier organisms, like those with hard shells and bony skeletons, and against creatures with soft bodies like jellyfish. Even having reached successful fossilization, these extraordinary objects will then have to withstand millions of years inside the ground, often in dynamic conditions, thanks to tectonic movements such as colliding continents and plate boundaries dragging them into the depths of the earth without being destroyed. They may be exposed and literally smash back into sediment, or perhaps the opposite, in which they find themselves drifting too close to a tectonic plate boundary, crushed in the depths or by pressure and melted down into magma. Finally, if they've made it to the modern day, they still need to rely on catching the eye of a passing fossil hunter who can recognize them for what they are. It would be an awful long way to come, only to be stepped over or casually kicked back into the sea. Despite all of this, fossils remain to be found almost everywhere in astonishing abundance. The reason for this is quite simple. Imagine all the animals alive today, and then imagine that number stretched across the vastness of time. Complex life has existed on this planet for over 500 million years. Suddenly, even that small percentage of organisms which are successfully fossilized add up to a huge observed number. To paraphrase a quote from comedian, writer and musician Tim Minchin, to call any one thing impossible is often to significantly underestimate the number of things that there are. Fossil types. Further to all of this, there are actually multiple types of fossils. For the purposes of this book, it is just the two main groupings that are important, body and trace. Body fossils are what we most commonly think of when we imagine fossils. A body fossil is the term for the physical remains of the organisms themselves, even if fully remineralized. For example, a dinosaur bone is a body fossil, as are the spiral shells of ammonites, a group of extinct marine mollusk animals, or the fossilized leaves of plants. If we're lucky enough to find multiple bones from a single specimen, all preserved together, in the position they would have been in during life, we call them articulated. However, the majority will not be this neat, and the bones might well be in isolation or scattered all over the place. In this case, we would refer to them as disarticulated. By the nature of their very existence, animals can't help but alter the world around them. A dinosaur walking along the mud of an ancient riverbank will leave footprints behind, and if left undisturbed, these too can be preserved in the rock record and be formed into fossils. The animal itself is long gone, but that trace of its existence remains, hence the name given to such findings, trace fossils. Or to use the original Greek word root science so loves to adopt, ichnofossils. Whilst trace fossils may at first seem a less exciting find than the flashier body fossils, trace fossils can be exceptionally useful, as they hold the secrets to reconstructing past behaviours of those creatures that lived before us. For example, the stride length of those footprints might tell us how fast the individual was walking. By measuring the distance between T-Rex footprints found in 2016, it was estimated that its walking speed was around 6 kilometres per hour. If multiple sets of trackways are found, then it can provide clues on social interactions, such as herding behaviour, seen in many herbivorous dinosaurs. Footprints are amongst the most glamorous of trace fossils, though. Far more common are those often overlooked, like invertebrate burrowing traces, which are found almost everywhere. Often appearing as no more than wriggling lines of a different hue in the rock, I don't often reference their presence at sites in this book, but with a knowledge of what to look for, you will find them. These burrows frequently appear in limestones, where they most commonly look like pale, almost white, wriggling lines surrounded by grey rock. The place in which trace and body fossils collide is where we get pathologies from. These are features on the body fossils which tell of behaviour. The most familiar of these are bite marks, still visible in long-dead bones, but they could also be injuries, as when bone breaks it tends to grow back thicker than before. All evidence of past life is written in these fossils. Other terms. Three other things will come up frequently during this book. Fossils are also not usually found scattered loose. Instead, more often than not, you will find them embedded within the rock. In this case, we call the surrounding rock the matrix. Everyone has heard of the word species before, but we will also be dealing with the word genus a lot. The scientific names of living things are made up of two parts, genus and species, for example, T. rex. The first word, Tyrannosaurus, is the genus, whilst the second word, rex, is the species. Often people will know only the genus name, but believe it to be the species. Everyone has heard of Triceratops, but how many know T. horridus or T. prausus? These are the two species of Triceratops. Each genus can have multiple species within it, as different from each other as Homo sapiens and Homo erectus. Following standard scientific rules, the genus, singular genera, will always be capitalized, the species not, with the whole name in italics. When talking of fossils, we also speak a lot about things happening millions of years ago. And because it's somewhat annoying to write that each time, the scientific world has adopted the shorthand MA. So if you see something written as 150 MA, that just means 150 million years ago. Kit and safety. Many people's perception of what a paleontologist might need when out exploring the field is often far more excessive than the reality. When posing this question to the general public about what one might need when searching for fossils, answers can vary from the ordinary calls of a pickaxe and spade to the extremes of dynamite and heavy farming equipment. As intrigued as I am to see how a combine harvester might fare sifting through fossils on the beach, the truth is that you really don't need very much at all to get you started. Fossil hunting is an outdoor pursuit and commonly involves scrambling over rocky, muddy, and uneven terrain. With this in mind, the most important kit of all is good outdoor gear, sturdy boots, trousers, and coats ready for all conditions. Paleontology is certainly not for those who wish to stay spotlessly clean. If you want to really get into it at some sites, you may well end up covered in a fair percentage of the beach. Luckily, most of the hard work of extraction has already been done for you by nature and the passage of time. The erosive processes of the sea, wind, and rain break the fossil beds into more easily manageable chunks, boulders, pebbles, or, if you're lucky, a fossil that has popped out in its entirety. All you really need for fossil hunting is a keen eye and patience. It's important not to lose heart if there are times when you come away having found little to nothing. It's an inevitability that happens to even the most seasoned of professionals with years of experience. If you do want to use specialist kit, then a hammer is the common tool of choice, though it's important to make clear that I'm referring specifically to geological hammers. Using the regular DIY kind can sometimes be actively dangerous, as they're not at all designed for dealing with material as sturdy as rock and can splinter or even shatter. What you need is a solid geology hammer. Every budding paleontologist tends to gather a collection of hammers over the years, with a variety of sizes to deal with different rock types and sizes. You may even grow attached to yours, as I have to my own hammer of choice these past few years, which I've nicknamed Paper, for its uncanny ability to beat rock every time. The use of a hammer does come with an additional caveat, however. Eye protection is vital when hammering. When you smash into a rock, splinters can fly into the air, and the last thing you want is to have one of those end up in your eye. I'd also highly recommend practicing on less precious bits of rock before going to hammer the impressive specimens. Rocks can sometimes break unpredictably, and it's best to hone your techniques on a few shelly fragments before you risk destroying your prized finds of the day. And this is something I say with bitter experience. Through time and practice, you'll learn the best places and ways in which to hit the rocks to have them fracture in the manner you're intending them to. Hammers and chisels often have a smash-and-grab feeling about them. But when it comes to some of the softer, thin-split shales, they aren't always right. Delicate fossils are best removed with careful use of a field knife. As you gain experience, you might try to tackle the trickier heavyweight fossil challenges with mallets and crowbars, but these are at the extreme ends of the collector's spectrum, and only for those who don't mind looking incredibly suspicious walking along the beach. Before moving on, we also need to have a few additional words about ensuring safety. Due to the way fossils are so often found, many of the localities in this book involve cliffs. Needless to say, large towers of heavy rocks come with some fairly self-explanatory risks. This is one of the most crucially important points with fossil hunting safety. There really isn't much need to go too near the cliffs at all. The fossils may have originated from there, but the best fossils don't stick around, instead dropping down to the beach below. You are far more likely to find decent fossils in the shingle a good way away from the cliffs than you ever are from directly underneath them. If you are working near the cliffs, it is also a good idea to have a hard hat on you. Small flecks of rock frequently come loose and tumble down the cliffs. These could cause nasty damage to an exposed head, but will usually bounce straight off a hard hat. When it comes to coastal localities, the tide can also be a big concern. One of the most essential bits of information needed when exploring the coast is the daily tide times. Fossil hunting is a calming and therapeutic activity, one in which you can lose yourself for hours walking along the seashore. But if you don't keep an eye on the tide, you could well find yourself cut off. And if there's one thing guaranteed to ruin that good mood, it's having to call the RNLI after being marooned while chasing bivalves. When to go? One of the best things about fossil hunting is the fact that it makes the most of being outdoors, hence why it jumps to mind as the perfect activity for the best days of summer, with glorious blue skies, balmy temperatures, and calm seas. Summer is certainly a good time to go, but there's far more to fossil hunting than that. What's truly wonderful about it is that there are few times it isn't worthwhile. Some weather that might ordinarily be considered bad can actually lead to the best conditions for finding fossils. For millions of years, the fossils have been trapped in the rocks, and in order to become accessible to us, they must first be broken free. It requires quite a bit of strength to smash open a cliff face, and it isn't the kind of thing likely to occur on a calm summer's day. But when the weather is at its worst, with the rains and winds violently crashing against the coasts, that's when the cliffs get shaken up and scatter the fossils on the ground below. We're constantly seeing storms turn over new secrets. Not long before I began writing this book, the news reported that winter storm Kiara had exposed a previously hidden and perfectly preserved dinosaur footprint set at Sandown on the Isle of Wight. Out of sight for over 100 million years, it was suddenly revealed by just a few days of rough weather. I should caveat this by saying that, naturally, a degree of common sense is necessary here. It is not wise to go out fossil hunting during the peaks of the storms, and the first priority should always be your safety. If the weather has any chance at all of putting you at risk, then it is best to stay sheltered until the worst is over. The days after such storms have passed, however, are frequently the most productive times to go hunting. Though again, it is still vital to be extra careful and steer particularly clear of cliffs, as they could be prone to collapse. There are some cases where even a little rain can boost your chances of making a discovery. I personally prefer fossil hunting in light rain, as I find it often boosts the contrast in the colours of the rock. On a sunny day, a fossil-bearing rock might look grey all over, but when wet in less harsh lighting, the contrast between the grey matrix and white fossils within can become visible from a greater distance. This is obviously dependent on the site in question, but it's true for quite a few cases. Seasonality has a big effect on success beyond just weather too. With coastlines being more prominent at certain intervals, like during spring tides, The waters can retreat further than normal, exposing new beds of rock which previously couldn't be reached, a rare extra opportunity for fossil searching. Sites of special scientific importance. One final thing to note is an acronym you'll come across a lot when exploring places for fossils, SSSI. This stands for Site of Special Scientific Interest, and it is more than just a title, as these areas come with their own set of protective rules as well. The single most important rule for our purposes is that as an SSSI, you're not allowed to damage the in-situ formations. This means you're not allowed to hammer at the rocks still in the cliffs. This rule does not apply to ex-situ material, meaning that which has fallen out of the cliff naturally. So you can't dig into the rock of a cliff directly, but if you see a chunk of rock from the cliff lying on the beach, then you are completely free to break it open legally. This isn't as big a setback as it might initially sound. As I've already said, you really don't need to spend much time close to cliffs anyway. Fossils are more likely to be found below the cliffs than in the cliff walls, and besides, hammering into the rock at the base of a cliff isn't a smart thing to attempt. It's not a good idea to tamper with the blocks at the base of a Jenga tower when that tower is over 30 metres tall and made of solid rock. These rules are in place specifically to keep the fossils and people involved safe. If you do come across what could be the beginnings of an amazing specimen in situ, there is a process that you should follow. First, make note of or mark the location, enabling you to find it again. Then contact either the relevant land authorities or local experts, museums or perhaps local geology groups, and report the find. These groups will assess the discovery to determine if it is significant and what to do next. This could be a full-scale excavation effort, or, much more likely, ensuring an eye is regularly kept on it to collect it as it slowly falls from the cliff, with it likely causing less harm to the fossil to let it erode out naturally. If you are heading out to a site in Scotland, then you need to be aware that Scotland has its own set of rules regarding fossil hunting. I will not write them all out here, but they can be easily found online by looking up the Scottish Fossil Code. With the practical elements finished with, we can now start to explore some of the amazing fossil hunting localities and discoveries these isles have to offer. Northern Scotland, Lewisian Gneiss. The far north of Scotland can, in places, appear to be a remote and barren wilderness, one of the very few areas in the UK that looks to be largely untouched by human activity. It is perhaps unsurprising, then, that it is here in these ancient lands that you can find the very oldest rocks the UK has to offer. Strange though it may seem for a book on fossil hunting sites, this first location does not contain any fossils whatsoever, but it does help to put everything that is to come into context. Generally speaking, the underlying rocks of the UK follow a very loose pattern, which is that the oldest rocks are towards the northwest and the youngest are in the southeast. It is far from a perfect correlation, as the dynamic nature of the earth means that there are windows of older or younger rocks wherever you look. Nevertheless, that general trend is the pattern we will attempt to follow in this book, moving down the country, region by region, starting with the oldest rocks and moving south towards the more modern-day formations. It doesn't get any older than the stunning rocks of the formation known as the Lewisian Gneiss. These rocks usually appear as dark grey in colour, with bands of pink crystalline rock running through them like painted waves. Found around the Outer Hebrides, upper estimates suggest they may be an astonishing 3.1 billion years old. It's an almost incomprehensibly huge number. To give you an idea of just how old these rocks are, it's worth considering that dinosaurs became extinct only 66 million years ago, putting dinosaurs like T-Rex 50 times closer in time to us than the period in which these rocks were formed. As the first word of the name suggests, this formation is named after where they were first described, on the Isle of Lewis, by John McCulloch in his 1819 works on the Western Scottish Islands. There is no one single site where they can be best seen, as they pop up in various places in this region, notably in areas such as Mearlister Beach. In fact, one of the best locations to see them is not on the island at all, but on the mainland at Scoury Bay. But what about the second half of the name, the word Gneiss? A gneiss is a type of rock. If you cast your mind back to science and geography, you may remember the three main types of rock: igneous, sedimentary, and metamorphic. Igneous rocks are those formed by volcanoes on the surface and magma deep within the earth. Sedimentary rocks are slowly laid down, grain by grain, over millions of years. Metamorphic are those same rocks that have been altered by heat and pressure to form something new. Those metamorphic rocks are further classified into grades from low to high. A low-grade rock hasn't been altered a great deal, whereas a high-grade rock has changed significantly. A gneiss is just such a high-grade metamorphic rock, not far off becoming the next step of migmatite, in which the rock has actually begun to partially melt back into magma. Essentially, these rocks have been through an almost literal hell. Under conditions of extreme heat and pressure, their chemical composition began to change. The very alignment of the elements composing their crystal structures changed. But the result can be quite beautiful, with wavy banding giving the rock an appearance similar to polished wood. These bands can be dark and black, grey and white, or even vibrant colours of rusted red and pink. Astonishingly, though, their age is not the reason for their lack of fossils, as extremely ancient remains of single-celled organisms have been discovered from around this time. The oldest preserved structure, upon which the scientific consensus agrees, is a fossil that is 3.4 billion years old. Some even claim to have found specimens even older than these Lewisian rocks, going back to 3.8 billion years old. Recent research, led by Dr. Holly Betts, has suggested that life actually may have existed prior to 3.9 billion years ago. This would mean life was already on the planet during a particularly volatile time in Earth history known as the Late Heavy Bombardment, when the Earth was being subjected to a prolonged attack from space debris. The reason there are no fossils to be found here is not the age of these rocks, but rather because they are simply the wrong type. Fossils almost exclusively form in sedimentary rocks, such as limestones, sandstones, mudstones, and shales. The extreme temperatures and pressures of metamorphism will almost always destroy any fossils. The only exceptions to this are in very low-grade metamorphic rocks, but even then the fossils can be altered beyond recognition. It might seem basic, but it is a fundamental lesson in fossil hunting: to ensure you are looking in the correct places. Igneous and metamorphic rocks will generally not yield fossil discoveries. If a rock is composed of angular crystals tightly bound together, as these are, then it's not going to contain fossils. If it is made of consolidated grains and sediment, such as sands and clays, then it could be worth investigating. Fossils require the sedimentary forms, the rocks laid down in beds at the bottom of the sea, in flowing rivers and lakes, or even in the sandy dunes of the deserts. It's a good idea to get acquainted with these types of rock, as you'll be dealing with them a lot when going into the field and looking for fossils. The Lewisian gneiss is in many ways an odd chapter to start this book on, not containing any fossils and not even being restricted to one geographical area that can be discussed. But it serves to show the enormous potential scope of paleontology, the vast amount of time life has been on Earth, and helps put everything we are about to move on to into a geological context. Caithness. From the oldest rocks in the land, we move to some of the northernmost, in the historic county of Caithness, home of one of Scotland's most significant geographical sites, John O'Groats. This is the furthest north point of the mainland of Great Britain. Although there are higher points on the map still marked as the UK, this is the highest you can reach on foot without getting wet. The geography isn't the only notable thing at John O'Groats, though. The rocks here do also have some potential for fossil hunting. The sandstones making up the shoreline here are a lot younger than the gneisses of Lewis, but they are still exceptionally old, dating back 385 million years, placing them in the Devonian period. Due to an explosion of diversity of one particular animal group at this time, the Devonian is frequently called the Age of Fish, and that's very apparent in the rocks here, as they are littered with fossilized fish scales. Unfortunately, most of the discoveries here are a complete jumble. You may well find hundreds of the scales within the loose red scree, but they are scattered around like debris from an explosion. The odds of finding any more complete remains around John O'Groats are low. However, more detailed and well-preserved finds can be uncovered only a few miles to the west on the beaches of the nearby town of Thurzo, in a geological formation named for the location, the Caithness Flagstone Group. All of the fish-bearing sites in this area were once a part of a giant body of fresh water called Lake Orcadi, which existed here during the Devonian period, the sediments preserving the fish that lived there. Many of the fossils from this lake are hidden today under the North Sea, but they can still be found in these Scottish exposures. The fish here are different from the ones we know of today, with many of them belonging to a group of armoured fish known as placoderms, which dominated the Devonian seas. These animals had thick armour plating extending from their heads to their pectoral fins, the horizontally orientated fins, or if you will, the fish equivalent of arms. When considering this group, most jump to its most famous member, the monstrous 5-metre-long predator, Dunkleosteus. But this genus is known to be almost entirely from North America, so you are unlikely to find any remains like that here. The most common fish of Lake Orcadi is the much smaller genus Homosteus, recognisable from its flattened and rather box-shaped head. From its head shape, it was presumed to have lived near the seafloor, feeding on invertebrates, much like the catfish of today. Complete specimens have been found preserved in large nodules of rock from Thurzo. But as with any great specimens in paleontology, they are very rare, and you're much more likely to find scattered and disarticulated remains. But if a nodule has washed out of the cliff and you feel confident in your skills with a hammer, then it could be worth inspecting inside. Thankfully, all the fossils here are quite easy to spot when they are exposed, thanks to the black and sometimes even reflective nature of many of the fish remains, contrasting with the light grey of the flagstones. The thin and relatively fragile layers of shale are easily split if the act of falling down the cliffs hasn't done the job for you. Thurzo's beaches are easy to access as being close to the town. The town itself has a classic sandy beach, but for the best chances of finding something of interest, you want to be on the east side of the river, where the land is dominated by agriculture and the coast made of flat rocks and low cliffs rather than sand. Fish beds are common around Caithness, with a massive abundance of species having been discovered at the nearby Akanaris Quarry. A former working quarry, now publicly accessible, the spoil heaps here are still sometimes rotated by heavy machinery, bringing previously buried material to the surface and thereby refreshing the potential to find new fossils. Other placoderms are common here, such as the round-headed Cocosteus. More than 15 fish species have been found here, including Osteolopis, a primitive lungfish ancestor on an evolutionary line closer to us. Of the fossil sites at the very apex of the country, Thurzo may be the most productive, and John O'Groats the most visited, but neither holds the title of the UK's Northern.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.